Okay, let me start by thanking the organizers for giving me this opportunity. What I'll be talking today is work in progress being done with David Polin at IQI Caltech on characterizing approximate quantum error correction. So we're all more than familiar with the background here, but it... Oops. I'm sorry.
There seems to be some...
Okay. So let me just recall the standard approach to quantum error correction, where we have this ideal notion of correctability, where a channel is said to be correctable on a code space C if there exists a trace-preserving recovery such that every state in the code space is brought back to itself under the action of R composed with A. And this naturally leads to conditions under which perfect error correction is possible, which were written down a long time ago. I just want to point out that these conditions are actually independent of the Krauss representation of the channel A and are easily checkable once the code space P is given. Okay, I have a problem with this. So we can formulate a problem of approximate correctability in a similar fashion by first starting to define the notion of approximate correctability, where a channel is said to be approximately correctable on code space C if under the action of if there exists a recovery map such that the action of R composed with A gives us back a state which is very close to the initial state in fidelity. And we can ask the question, is it possible to characterize approximate error correction in the sense that can we find an easily checkable condition for approximate quantum error correction? We can also ask a related question on the robustness of perfect error correction, by which I mean what happens when the Knill-Laflamme condition is only approximately satisfied. Is it still possible to get back the information that's encoded in the code space with high enough fidelity? Intuitively, we would think the answer is yes. If that is so, then what is a good recovery to use to recover your information with high enough fidelity? As was pointed out in the first talk today morning by Peter Schur, one has a choice of fidelity measures to choose from. One can either formulate this question with the entanglement fidelity, or one can talk about the worst case fidelity, in which case every state in the code space would be brought back to itself with high enough fidelity. So let me first talk about the question of approximate correctability with high entanglement fidelity. So an answer was actually given, an answer can be found out from work that was done by Barnum and Knill some years ago. So their prescription is as follows, that to be able to approximately correct this channel A with Krauss operators AI on code space C, we construct this recovery map, which I call RBK for Barnum-Knill, whose Krauss operators are essentially the Krauss operators of the adjoint channel of A, with a prefactor and a postfactor added to make this trace preserving. And how do we know that this is a good recovery to work with? We know this from the result, which essentially says that the Barnum-Knill recovery, the entanglement fidelity, but when you use the Barnum-Knill recovery, is not less than the square of the entanglement fidelity with any old trace-preserving recovery map. So to be more precise, if we have a trace-preserving recovery map R, which does very well, which recovers with very high entanglement fidelity, then we know that the Barnum-Knill recovery does not do too badly either. So this naturally leads to a condition for an easily checkable condition for approximate correctability, where all we need to do is just check for the entanglement fidelity with the Barnum-Knill recovery. But of course, there is a factor of 2 here, so this recovery is only optimal to within a factor of 2. There's been more recent work done on finding the optimal recovery for recovering with high entanglement fidelity, and we heard about some of that today morning. So there is work by Andrew Fletcher and Peter Schur and collaborators where they use semi-definite programming to solve this problem. And we also heard on Wednesday on Robert Kossuth and Daniel Lidar's approach using convex optimization to solve this problem. So this was just my brief digression, so to say, on entanglement, on high entanglement fidelity of recovery. The question that we were actually interested in is how do we recover with high worst case fidelity? And it's tempting to kind of just try and use the Barnum-Knill recovery, which seems to do so well for the entanglement fidelity. But right now, the kind of bounds we have are not very good with this recovery. But it may still be possible that the Barnum-Knill recovery does at least close to optimal, like it does in the case of entanglement fidelity. So the approach we took was kind of different, where we are. asked, is it possible to get approximate codes by just relaxing the perfect error correction condition? So what do I mean by relaxing it? So let's go back and see what the perfect error correction condition tells us. So a perfectly correctable channel, channel A is perfectly correctable on C, if it has a representation, if it has a cross representation such that the cross operators map the code space to mutually orthogonal subspaces of the Hilbert space, which are also undistorted versions of the code space in the sense that they are mere unitary transforms of the code space. So, in other words, there exists a set of cross operators AI such that PAI adjoint AJP is proportional to delta IJ. So there are kind of two components to this condition. One is that these code spaces that the different cross operators map, the subspaces that the different cross operators map your code space to are mutually orthogonal, plus they are just unitary transforms of the initial code space. So an approximate code that just relaxes one of these constraints was obtained in work done by Debbie and co-authors, where they had this 4-qubit code for the amplitude damping channel. Again, we've heard about this earlier today. So we can try and understand how the Debye et al. Code works by drawing a similar picture, where what the cross operators do is to again map the code space to mutually orthogonal subspaces, but these are no longer unitary transforms of the initial code space, but not distorted non-unitary transforms of the code space. So we can try and write down an algebraic condition that characterizes such a class of channels, and that leads us to a sufficient condition for approximate correctability. So what this is if there exist these real positive numbers lambda and positive operators bi such that the cross operators of the channel in the canonical representation satisfy such a condition, then we can construct a trace preserving recovery such that the worst case fidelity is high. The measure I use for worst case fidelity is essentially a minimization over all pure states of the overlap between the initial state and the final state. So just look at this condition more closely. What these delta IJs are telling you is that the code space is still being mapped to mutually orthogonal subspaces, but what the BI is doing is it's telling you that they're no longer unitary. So the BIs are actually a measure of the deviation from unitarity of the action of the cross operators. And here we're just bounding these BIs from above. And the norm that I'm using here is merely the operator norm, because the BIs, as I said, are positive operators. So this is essentially the operator norm of the sum of the BIs, so that the total deviation from unitarity is small. And then we can show that we can recover with a fidelity that again is restricted by this bound epsilon. So how do we construct this recovery? Notice that when you do a polar decomposition of your cross operators, you obtain these unitaries ui. So this polar decomposition is essentially telling you that the cross operators are almost unitary on the code space because the bi's are very small, they're bounded by epsilon. So it's sufficient to just use the adjoint of these unitaries ui to write down your recovery map. So the recovery is merely an adjoint, the adjoint of these unitaries followed by a projection on the code space. And this is essentially the kind of recovery that you use in perfect error correction also. So this condition, again, is still restricted, like I said, because we're still demanding that the code space is mapped to only orthogonal subspaces. So we ask the question, is it possible to write down a condition for the action of an arbitrary channel? And what does an arbitrary channel do? To go back to this picture, which I really like, we map the code space to a set of subspaces which are not necessarily mutually orthogonal. In fact, to put it more strongly, there exists no cross representation of the channel where this PAI adjoint AJP is going to be zero. So not only is the code space being distorted in a non-unitary fashion, but also there is a finite non-zero overlap between these different subspaces that the cross operators are mapping the code space to. So the question is, can we write down a condition that characterizes this most general class of channels, and can we find a recovery that recovers with high fidelity of the code space? And the answer, it turns out, is yes. So the condition we have looks like this. So the first two conditions are essentially what I had written down earlier, but what is different now is that these PAI adjoint AJP are no longer zero, and the norm of this PAI adjoint AJP, which is a measure of the overlap between these different subspaces, is bounded by this delta. And if this is indeed the case, then we can write down a trace-preserving recovery such that the worst-case fidelity is high. The norm that I'm using here is actually the spectral norm, which is merely the maximum singular value of these operators, PAI adjoint AJP. Also notice that one does not have any ugly factors of either the number of Krauss operators or the dimension of the code space figuring in this fidelity bound that we have. So let me just briefly tell you what kind of recovery we construct. So once again, suppose we do this polar decomposition of the Krauss operators and we know that they're approximately unitary, but the problem is we can no longer use these unitaries to recover with high enough fidelity because they're not orthogonal in this sense. So the intuitive, it's kind of obvious that one has to use some kind of Gram-Schmidt procedure to construct a set of a different set of operators which would mimic the action of the Krauss operators of the actual Krauss operators of the channel, but would also be orthogonal. And so it turns out that we were able to construct this kind of use this Gram-Schmidt-like procedure. I say Gram-Schmidt-like because the orthogonality that we are demanding is not actually an orthogonality in the sense of a norm or an inner product. It's this kind of overlap orthogonality. And in this construction, what we're essentially doing is from each unitary
subtracting out the part that overlaps with the action of the other Krauss operators,
and we do this in some kind of iterative fashion. We have these inverse operators sitting here in this construction. It turns out that these inverses actually exist on the code space because not only are they bounded from above, but they're also bounded from below by 1 minus delta. So these WIs are not actually unitary, but they are in fact partial isometries on the code space. And we can iteratively show that these inverses exist, and therefore this construction goes through. So at the end of the day, we have a set of WIs which are orthogonal in this sense, and so we can use them to construct our recovery map. So the recovery Krauss operators are essentially the adjoints of these WIs followed by a projection on the code space, and we showed that this recovers with high worst case fidelity. So what we're doing by constructing these WI is essentially generating a set of mutually orthogonal subspaces. So if we write down the action of each WI on the code space, this is a set of positive operators that have disjoint support. And how do we know they have disjoint support? Is because of this orthogonality condition. So these are a set of positive operators with disjoint support. So the support of these MIs is actually a set of mutually orthogonal subspaces which approximate the action of the channel to a high degree of fidelity, and that is why we're able to obtain a high worst case fidelity of recovery. So to conclude, what we've outlined is a sufficient condition for approximate quantum error correction, which characterizes a very general class of approximate codes. And in the process, we have shown that the perfect error correction condition is robust in the sense that even if we deviate slightly from the Knill-Laflamme condition, we are able to construct a recovery that recovers with high fidelity in the worst case. So what we are working on right now is to see if we can use this condition to construct some interesting examples, in particular if we can use this to obtain trade-offs between code lengths and fidelities for some common error channels, and in particular for non-poly error channels. There are also other interesting questions that one can ask. One obvious question is to ask if this condition is also necessary for approximate correctability, by which I mean if we have if we have a code that does very well, that recovers with high fidelity, then does it have the kind of structure that we needed in our sufficiency condition? If that is the case, then it would mean that any approximate code can be visualized as some kind of perturbation of the Knill-Laflamme code. So that could be an interesting question to answer. And the other question was what I mentioned earlier about whether the Barnum-Knill recovery is actually something that works close to optimal for the worst case, for recovering with high worst case fidelity as well. And such a condition would also give us some kind of necessary and sufficient condition for approximate correction, which is independent of a Knill-Laflamme-like characterization. So that's all that I had to say. Thank you.
You have to subtract off this bit for all the previous.
Right.
Why does it cause the fidelity to decrease with the number of?
Yes, that's kind of what you would expect. But if I have to go back, so you can kind of understand it by looking at the way I've written out these conditions. So it's I'm saying that what is bounded is actually the sum of all these overlaps. So it turns out that this actually pays off, and that's why one is able to get rid of any factors, like I said. Yeah, that's essentially. Yes?
How dependent is the satisfying of these conditions on your choice of the Krauss operator representation of the channel?
You know, right, yeah, so that's, yeah, that's something that we've not been able to get rid of in this case. You're right. So these conditions actually seem to depend on the Krauss representation. One thing that I'm looking into is if I can somehow merge these together into a Krauss representation independent form, that would be really good. But as of now, they are indeed representation independent. Yes?
Have you tried representing them in the
super operator? No, I actually don't know exactly how it would work out in the super operator representation. But yeah, that's definitely something we need to look at. Yes?
The WIs are isometries, they're not unitaries.
No.
So have you thought about how they would be implemented?
Yes, that was a question that I thought about. But at the end of the day, one is able to get a TPCP map. Right? One has a set, which we know is definitely implementable, but yeah, I haven't thought of circuits to actually implement this.
Thank you.